Good morning, church family. We invite you to come in as we get started. We're going to open our service today with His Name is Wonderful, and I invite you to stand as we sing this. I think you all know this song, so let me hear you sing out.
Thank you, praise team. We appreciate that very much. Good morning, church. How are you doing today? You may be seated, please. I'd like to say welcome to each one of you. We are glad you're here. This is the place to be on the Sabbath in God's church with His people, and we are so glad you're here. It's always good when we can come together after a busy week. Has it been busy this week? All right, I'm glad you have a busy time during the week also. And it's Sabbath is a relaxing time, but a time that we can be blessed too. You know, I heard some stories about our ski trip. You guys heard those stories? Well, it sounded like a disaster zone almost. We had so many injuries, but people are doing better, and there's a few surgeries even, but we want to pray for their recovery, and we're glad the rest of the ski trip is back here with us. Again, we're glad you're here. The Lord has always blessed us from Sabbath to Sabbath, and I know today will not be any different than that. I've got just a few announcements I need to go over with you. The men's Bible study group, they're meeting again, have been meeting, and I want you to remember that this coming Wednesday at our church at 6:30 p.m., men's study group. And also in the bulletin, there's a prayer and revival meeting that's mentioned there. That has been canceled. No prayer and revival meeting tonight. They will have a meeting next month, and so we look forward to that time, but there's no meeting tonight. Please let people know that. We've got some transfers of membership we need to vote in. And one out. We're both in and out. There are two transfers in. Robert and Patricia Saldana, they're coming to us from the Arlington Spanish Central Church. And I wish they'd stand. People need to recognize you guys. I need to pick on you just a minute. And your daughter's name is what? Sylvia. Okay, all right. Guys, how many want to say welcome? Welcome to these guys. All right. All right, we are glad you're here. Thank you. We have one transfer out. We have to we hate to lose our members, but Pam Claiborne is moving her membership to the Crowley Church, and on all of these transfers, I need a vote at this time. Is there action? All right. Second. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much. It carried. If you would, just to, as we continue in our service, it's our custom to kind of stand now as we continue for prayer at this time, please. Please stand with me for prayer. Our Father in heaven, it's very good that we can be here together in your presence. We ask that you will be with us today. I would ask that you would grant a blessing to each one here. Let us know that you are very close to us as we worship and praise your name today. And may our worship be acceptable to you, is my prayer. Amen. While you're up, please take a moment to greet those around you. Again, thanks for being in the Burleson Church today. Okay, guys, it's good that we can greet each other. Wayne Mitchell has some information on money today, and I'm sure we'll all want to hear that. So, information on money. We got to hear what you've got to say.
Good morning, church family. This week's tithe and offerings, the main emphasis is Texas Vision. And the special emphasis is local evangelism. So please give generously for these causes. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, you created us, and all good things come from you. This morning, we return our tithes and offerings, and we ask that you bless them, multiply them for your glory. In Jesus' name, I pray these things. Amen. Now it's time for the children's story. So, kids, come on up.
Good morning, boys and girls. Would you like to see what I brought in my box today?
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. My dad used to be quite a rock collector. He loved rocks, and he knew the names of all of them and what they were, and I would listen patiently and but not really remember them, if you know what I mean. So I'm not a rock expert, but I do enjoy looking at rocks, and sometimes I pick up rocks and enjoy them. So I brought a few of my rocks to show you. And this one I picked up on the playground. And something interesting about it, it's a piece of lava rock. And that means it's come out of a volcano somewhere, right? Which makes it really cool. But it has lots and lots of little holes in it, and it's not very heavy. So it's an interesting rock because it's not very heavy. This is a rock I picked up on a trip to Big Bend. I didn't pick it up in the park. You're not allowed to take things out of the park. But I got it near Big Bend, and it was just a really cool rock. It looks kind of like a egg, but little things are bursting out of it all over the place. Dr. Chadwick said it's chert and something else, and I don't remember what the something else was. I forgot. I'm sorry. Some rocks are really pretty. That one's purple, and it's real and shiny, and it's really, really pretty, right? Sometimes when I travel, like the one at Big Bend, I picked this one up just in Arkansas, just because I thought it was cool. It's not as pretty as the purple one, is it? But just sometimes when I travel, I think, oh, I'd like to take a rock home, and I do. Here's another pretty one. It's kind of gray, but look at all the sparkly things in it. You see how it sparkles? Do you know what it's like on the inside? I don't either. I can't see inside the rock, can I? If I crack it open, then I could. You are absolutely right. And here's another one I got in Arkansas because I love blue. Isn't that pretty? Sometimes, you know, rocks are kind of plain looking, but somebody does crack them open to see what they look like inside. And look at that one. Isn't that pretty on the inside? And who would have known? If you saw that laying out on the playground, would you go, wow, I bet there's crystals inside there? Probably not, because most of the rocks on our playground really don't have crystals inside them. But sometimes they do, and that is just gorgeous. And it reminds me of a story in the Bible. God told Samuel, I want you to go to Jesse's house. And I'm going to point out somebody special, and you're going to anoint him to be the next king. And so he went to Jesse's house, and he said, Jesse, I'd like to meet your sons. And Jesse's like, oh, wow, Samuel wants to meet my sons. And he called in the oldest. And his oldest was a nice, big, strong, handsome man. And Samuel went, whoa, this must be the one. He looks like a king. And he's getting ready to step forward, and God whispers in his ear, and he says, no. It doesn't matter what he looks like on the outside. It only matters what he's like on the inside, and this is not the one. He looks really good outside, like some of my rocks, but on the inside, it's just stone. And one by one, all those boys came in. And in my Bible story here, sorry. Saul got through all the sons, and he said, is this all you have? And Jesse said, well, there's the runt out in the field. And he says, well, call him in. And when he came in, he was not real tall, but he was really healthy looking and cheerful looking. And God whispered in his ear, and he said, this is the one, because he's beautiful on the inside. And we need to remember when we're choosing our friends and looking at other people, it's not the outside that's important. It's not the clothes. It's not the hair. It's not even if they're pretty or ugly. What does it matter? What is the important thing? That they're nice and that they're kind and that they love God. So God looks at the heart of people. And we need to start looking for the heart of people and not get so caught up in what the outside looks at. Thank you for looking at my rocks and listening to my story, and you may go sit down. Thank you.
it's time for us to lift our voices in praise. All the music this morning is centered on the theme of God's name. It is our prayer that the message of these songs will reach deep down into your heart and will draw up the praise and the adoration that you have for God and His great name. We're going to start out by singing Our God Saves, and I invite you to stand with us. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on your grace. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We're gathered together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on your grace. Hear the joyful song of our offering, as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves. Our God saves.
Jesus, your name will break every Jesus, your name is life. Jesus, your name is holy. Jesus, your name brings light. Jesus, your name above every other. Jesus, your name is life. Your name above every other, Jesus, your name is love.
Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Your name is like a strong tower, and the righteous run to it and are safe. Your word says that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord is saved. Thank you, Jesus. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save. But your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
my Savior, you are my King.
This song is our Garden of Prayer song. And in a couple of slides, you'll be invited down to bring your praises to the Lord, either at the front or in your pew, as we lift up our heartfelt praises and thank the God of our salvation. Sing Jesus, sing the name of
Jesus.
We worship the name of
Jesus.
We bow before you,
Jesus.
There is no other name but Jesus.
Slain for us, the Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise Jesus. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us, the Son of God and man.
Father in heaven, it's good that we can be here together on thy Sabbath in your house of worship with your people. We pray that you will be here with us as we worship you. You have called us your sons and daughters, and we're thankful for that. We're glad that we can be a part of your family. In Steps to Christ, you've told us that prayer is the opening of the heart to you as to a friend, and in the same page, you tell us to keep our cares and our needs before you, and we would do that just now. We thank you for taking care of everything that bothers us, and we praise your name for the many good things that you've done for each one. Satan's attacks are hard and frequent, and we would just ask that you help us every day to overcome. This morning we would pray for our nation. In America, we have the opportunity to worship you, and it's a blessing to live here. And we would pray that, again, you would guide our leaders as they look for direction and balance to lead this great country. I would pray for this church and the people here. We're thankful for salvation that we have through Christ. Again, that we would ask that you would forgive our many sins. May your Spirit lead out in our lives. And we would also ask that there would be physical healing for our members, because we know that you can heal just with your touch. And we thank you for that. We're thankful for our school. Your children are there. Your teachers are there. We need your presence there also, and we would ask for that just now. As the children learn more about you, guide in their lives, and again, we would just pray that you would keep them safe from the devil. We have to pray for the city of Burleson and the community around about it. Let the people know that they need you in their lives, and we would ask that you would help us to be effective witnesses to them. We are thankful for pastors, Elder Long and Elder Morris. They're giving good direction here, and we're very thankful for that. Pastor Wyan has our service today, and as he presents your word to us, we would just pray that you would guide him, because we know that information is so vital at this time. As we continue in our worship just now, We would just ask that you would be with us. We're ready to do your will, and we would just pray that you would be with us this morning in a special way, is my prayer. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you, praise team. Appreciate that. As we transition into the time where we're going to open the Word together, I want to just remind you briefly about something coming up a week from today here in Burleson. We have a guest speaker next Sabbath, and he is from Muslim Outreach Ministries. And Sure Harvest Ministries, there's a couple of ministries rolled into one. But his name is Gerald Babanajad, and he is going to be presenting some information in the sermon, but especially in the afternoon. He's going to be presenting a seminar called Seeing Jesus Through Muslim Eyes. And he has some really, really incredible perspectives to share regarding regarding the Quran and what it says about Jesus, how you can help someone from a Muslim background with their own book to build their courage about taking steps towards seeing Jesus as truly God based on what the Quran says, as well as a lot of other information that he has to share, understanding people from a Muslim background, where they come from, how they think, how you can develop friendships and relationships with people. And that's really the key to bringing people into the Christian faith, isn't it? He also talks a lot about the uniqueness of the Adventist message and how it is particularly suited to reaching Muslims. And so I would just encourage you, if you have any interest at all, to attend next Sabbath. We will have childcare. For those who are, I guess, maybe a little bit older, maybe 3 and up, until you're at an age, maybe 10 or 11. So 3 to 10 or 11, somewhere in that neighborhood. So we will have childcare available if you need it. He's also going to start, before he gets started at 2:30, he is going to, by the way, I guess I'm skipping something else. If you want to take part in this seminar next Sabbath afternoon, there will be a meal. If you want to come, bring some food, stay by for a meal, and that way you don't have to rush home and rush back, try to be here by 2 o'clock to hear the music he's going to share, and then at 2:30 the seminar beginning. So 2:30 to 4:30 is what we're planning for the seminar, and he is an incredibly talented musician, Gerald Babanajad, a classically trained pianist. In fact, he did a little mini concert here at our church Friday night a few months back. I took some video. I'm going to share with you just a little clip of that. Oh, I'm sorry. We may need to re-cue that. Let me see if I can go back. All right. Oh, it's going. All right. All right, maybe we can just lower the volume. I didn't crop it and crop the video, so you can tell, though, he is one of the most talented classically trained pianists that I've seen in person. But wow, what a blessing that was for the few of us who were here, Nancy, and a few others. But what a blessing it was. If you enjoy music and good classical sacred piano music, you're not going to want to miss that either. So a little commercial there next Sabbath here at the Burleson Church. And I know I'm looking forward to it, even though I've been through and heard all of it before. Looking forward to that again. You know, it's as we are talking about leading up to some meetings this spring, I am excited. I am really excited. I know that sometimes there is also this fear as we think about witnessing to other people, though. Today I want to share a story with you starting out, and then we'll come back around to it. about a time when I said to the Lord, okay, throw me out into the harvest field. Let's see how this goes, you know? It was a time when I was about a year into pastoral ministry. The church in Clinton, Arkansas, which was a church of about 50 members and a town of about 2,500 people in kind of north central Arkansas. They had a really neat little church and neat people, very kind, very loving. And we decided we were going to do some meetings and try to do it on a slim budget, and I decided I was going to preach the meetings. And I was so excited. I remembered a cornflakes commercial from years before that said, cornflakes, try them again. Anyone remember this? For the first time. Anyone remember that now that I finished it? Okay, a few people. See a few hands. I thought that was the coolest thing. Is I meditated on what we should title the series, how we should advertise it. We advertised it, Jesus, try him again, .. for the first time. And I was so excited. You know, I was thinking, oh, we're going to do prophecy, we're going to do the law and the Sabbath, we're going to do all of these wonderful teachings, hell and God's perspective, his plan for hell. It's not to burn people forever. But I was so excited how we were just going to see Jesus in every single doctrine that was taught and every single thing that we looked at. God's sovereignty and omniscience and prophecy, his love and compassion in the gospel, his character and his law and all of these other beautiful teachings, his desire to be united with his people, the second coming and the end time events. And I was so excited for these meetings. First night at the Senior Center in Clinton, Arkansas. We had some good member support. We had maybe 15 visitors or so. And I was excited for that, you know, a community of that size, and praising God for that. As the meetings went along, things began to dwindle and dwindle, and finally we had one lady coming that was a visitor. And she had just had this beautiful awakening about, and even shared a testimony in the middle of one of our meetings about how she had seen God's love through the Bible teaching of hell. She said, I'd never seen God like that before. I was praising God for that, and I thought, Lord, would you bring her to the last meeting? I'm going to have a call. The last meeting came. And not a single visitor. I was praying, maybe you'll bring somebody else out from other nights earlier in the meetings, and you'll just supernaturally work to bring somebody else out. And I haven't continued to visit this one lady even after the meetings, and she never made a decision, never came through for baptism. I thought, Lord, that morning at church, I've got a sermon ready with a call for baptism. Where do I go from here? Do I teach something different today? Kind of on the spot, do I put together a message last minute and teach on something else? Do I preach the sermon but not have a call for baptism? None of the people who were visiting at the meetings were there. What do I do? Do I continue to preach the message and have a call? What do I do? I'm going to come back to that story a little bit later. Have you ever been there before in the you have allowed God the privilege of throwing you out into ministry somewhere or a witnessing opportunity, and you think, what do I do from here? Lord, I'm kind of lost here. Help me. Has anyone ever had an experience similar to that before? You're following Jesus in the Great Commission, and you're taking him up on the challenge to go and make disciples. Okay, Lord, now what? Because if we're honest, there are some things that loom on the horizon for us, aren't there? The fear of failure, the fear of rejection, the fear of not knowing what to say next, or not having the answer to a question. All kinds of fears that that we have. But I want to encourage you about something as we begin today. In the Bible, we find this title for God, yes, for Jesus himself. He is the Lord of the harvest. He is the Lord of the harvest. You are not the Lord of the harvest. I'm not the Lord of the harvest. He is the Lord of the harvest. And the harvest truly is great, isn't it? We read that in Scripture. The harvest truly is great. Do we believe that today? Because if we believe that, then that probably means that there is something else that is true as well. That you probably know somebody who's ready for the harvest, and you just might not know it yet. You might even know more than one someone who is ripe for the harvest, and you don't know it yet. And God's just waiting for us to get in tune with him, to listen to his voice, be willing to respond to his call, to go out as laborers into the harvest. Luke 10, verses 2 through 4, up on the screen here. Then he said to them, "The harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Therefore pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go your way. Behold, I send you out as lambs among wolves. Carry neither money bag, knapsack, nor sandals, and greet no one along the road." I wonder if partway through Jesus' commissioning of the 70 here in Luke chapter 10, if they're saying, okay, wait a second, wait. Where do we go from here? No money? No money bag? No knapsack? What are we talking about here? In his book entitled The Radical Prayer, Derek Morris kind of unpacks some of this. And here's what he says about this idea of a money bag. He says in Matthew 10, verse 9, as Jesus, in other words, sends out the 12, not the 70, but the 12, he's even more specific. He says to the 12, they shouldn't take any gold, silver, or copper money with them. Jesus was trying to teach the disciples what? Dependence on self? No. Dependence upon him. Complete and total dependence upon him. Don't take a money bag. Don't take any money. Don't even try to hide gold coins in your sandals. I don't know where how you'd carry, you know, back in those days. I don't know if they had pockets or not. It's good. Just thought of that. Luke 10, verse 4 also says, or a knapsack. And Derek Morris unpacks that a little bit too. He says, in the ancient Greek literature, this Greek word, which is only used six times in the New Testament, is described as a beggar's bag in ancient Greek literature. In other words, don't take any money with you, and don't even take this thing that teachers would sometimes take from town to town saying, if you want to give me some money, you can. You know, I'm teaching, and obviously I've earned my wages, so give me some money. You hear the message here? I want complete dependence on me. I want you to completely take yourself out of the equation. You don't know how things are going to happen. You don't know how I'm going to provide. And that's exactly where I want you. I want you to step out in faith and put your faith completely in me. And spiritually, I wonder if the same is true for us today. We come to those points. Where from here? What do I do now? God says, that's exactly where I want you. I don't want you to know the end from the beginning. I want you to have faith in me. By the way, later on, Luke chapter 10, later on, he says, did you guys have lack for anything? And they said, no. We had everything we needed. You guys have these prayer lists, don't you? These cards here. They're 20 spaces here. You've probably been building your list of names of people you're praying for. If you have gotten one of these in a Sabbath school class or picked one up at the Connect Corner, I'd like to ask our deacons at this time if you guys would just run through the audience real quick. If you don't have one of these, I just encourage you to grab one. It is a way of just intentionally thinking, okay, Lord, who do you want me to be praying for as we're coming up to the meetings here in just right around 2 months, a little bit shy of that. Who do you want me to be praying for? I need your wisdom here. Who is it that you want me to be just ministering to, praying for, discipling, leading to you, maybe encouraging someone who has kind of slipped by the wayside or stopped attending church? Maybe it's a non-Christian, a non-Adventist. Build your list, and this, you could tuck it away in your Bible or in a devotional book and just kind of keep it there so that every time you're having time with the Lord, you can just lift up these names and maybe specific things. Sometimes just lifting up the list in general as well. But build your list and be praying for these people. These cards are just one tool to do that. You could make notes in your Bible if you wanted to, honestly, in the back of your Bible. It doesn't have to be this card here. But we ask, okay, I've got my names. I'm praying for them. What now? Where do I go from here? Might I suggest that we follow Jesus' example? John chapter 5, verse 17 and verses 19 and 20. It says here, but he answered them, my Father is working until now, and I myself am working. People were questioning, wait, why did you do a miracle on the Sabbath? What's going on here? And Jesus is answering some of their questions. Verse 19, therefore Jesus answered and was saying to them, truly, truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself unless it is something he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, these things the Son also does in like manner. I love Jesus' model for how he chose where he's going to get involved in ministry. The author of the book Experiencing God, Henry Blackaby, he says this about this passage. He says, Jesus did not take the initiative in what he did for the Father. Let that sink in for a moment. It doesn't mean he wasn't acting, right? But he did not move out and take the initiative. Only the Father is the initiator. The Father had been working throughout history and was carrying out his purposes in Jesus' time on earth. The Father let the Son know what he was doing. When Jesus saw the Father's activity, that was Jesus' invitation to join his Father. Jesus did not ever have to guess what he should do, nor did he have to dream up what he could do for the Father. Rather, he simply watched to see what the Father was doing around him, and he immediately aligned his life that way. Then the Father accomplished his purposes through Jesus. What a radical thought. How did Jesus decide what he was going to do in ministry according to Jesus himself? He watched for where the Father was at work, and he got involved where the Father was working. He sought out his Father for discernment, in essence. He was not willing to trust his own human instincts, which he was fully human, right? He had a human will, human instincts. He was not willing to trust his own human instincts regarding where he should be working and what he should be doing or how to do it. He depended completely on his Father for guidance. Where are you working? What do you want me to do? How do you want me to do it? Is it possible that the devil has us so consumed with ourselves, with our busy schedules, with our problems, with our habits, with our weaknesses, that making disciples is the last thing on our minds? What if we were so immersed in Christ and in his word that it was the first thing on our minds all the time? What if that were the case, that everything else in life revolved around making disciples? What would life look like? What would our work life look like? Would anything change? How about in our daily activities? How about in our schedules? How about in our home? How about in our relationships or in our investment in other people's lives? You fill in the blank. How's God speaking to you this morning? You see, discipleship happens primarily through relationships, doesn't it? That was Jesus' model. He discipled people in relationships. Is there space in our lives for that to happen? Discipleship, true discipleship. Are we following the Spirit? Are we looking for where the Father's at work? Praying for discernment. Don't we need to pray? Where do we go from here? Well, we need to be praying for discernment, depending wholly upon God. Where do we go? What do we do? How do we do it? Jeremiah 1, verses 7 through 9 tells us something else we can be praying for, because there's something else that we need, not just discernment to know where to go and what to do. But look at Jeremiah 1 as a part of his call. But the Lord said to me, do not say, I am a youth, because everywhere I send you, you shall go, and all that I command you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. Then the Lord stretched out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. Isn't that good news that God can put his words in my mouth? Because guess what? I don't have the wisdom to say to somebody what they need when they need to hear it. Praise God, he can put his words in my mouth. Oh, that's only true for Jeremiah the prophet. Oh, really? Well, let's go back to the New Testament, and let's look at Matthew 10, where Jesus is commissioning the 12 to go out and to minister. He says here to the 12, but when they hand you over, do not worry about what you are to say, for it will be given you in that hour what you are to say. For it is not you who speak, but it is the Spirit of your Father who speaks in you. Wow. What a privilege. What a privilege. Does that require dependence on God? Absolutely. Wholehearted, focused dependence on him. I don't know what I'm going to say, but I want to be sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit. I want to be sensitive to what's going on, what the other person's saying, well, what's going on in their life. How can I minister to them? I need to be praying. Before, during, after encounters with people, praying. I've asked a few young people to help me with some role-playing today, so you can kind of get some of you already are active in witnessing and engaging with people. Some of us are very afraid. And if that's the case for you, I just want you to see a little snippet of what it might look like. Now, let me set this up for you. One person has a very hard assignment out of these groups of two, and the other person has an easier assignment, okay? And so the two girls are going to come first, and they're going to, Taylor and Megan, they're going to kind of interact with one another a little bit. And let's see, remind me who's got the hard assignment, who has? Hard assignment. Taylor took the hard assignment here. So she does not know what Megan's getting ready to say. She's going to be listening, observing, and granted, this isn't a real-life situation, right? But this just is a demonstration of the dependence we have to have on God to help us, to tune in our senses, all right? So I'm going to turn it over to you guys and go for it. Oh, grab some mics, yes. Oh, green, yeah, purple, whatever. Yeah, that's fine. All right.
Yeah, okay, it works.
Hey, what's up?
Hey, how are you feeling? Are you okay?
Fine, I guess.
Fine? Okay. Just are you sure?
Well, I guess you could say that when it rains, it pours.
Really? Is it something wrong with the kids?
Well, My 11-year-old daughter got in trouble at school. She got suspended, and I don't know what I'm doing wrong. But, and then also, like, the landlord decided to sell the house, and so now I have a month and a half to figure out where I'm going to live. And now, and on top of all that, my dad is just diagnosed with cancer.
Oh my gosh, I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
Just, how are you handling it all? Are you okay?
I'm really overwhelmed right now, honestly.
Overwhelmed? Well, I don't know if this will help. I know it helps me. One of my favorite verses I always keep with me is right here. So you can have it if you want. It's 1 Peter 5:6-7, and it says, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you." So whenever you're struggling, just read that and remember that he's there for you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, I pass those mics on to them. Let me set this one up a little bit. By the way, let's thank the ladies here for helping us. All right, I'll tell you guys as much as Henry knows. Henry's got the tough assignment here, all right? He doesn't know much. He knows that his good friend, Miles, here is, well, they're high school students, okay? He knows that recently on social media, he has seen some people bullying Miles and also kind of piling on, and that's all he knows. But I'm going to turn it over to them and let them take it from here. Henry is kind of trying to be there for his friend, witness to him in some way at this time.
Hey, how you doing?
What's up? I'm doing fine. Everything's great. Yeah. How are you?
You seem a little tense when you say great. Are you certain?
I don't know, man. I don't really feel like talking right now. Life's just not the best.
Well, I know about that. Life, you know, for us could be much better. But are you certain you don't want to talk about it? Because I got nothing to do.
Yeah. So you know how Tracy and I's first year anniversary was a couple weeks ago?
Yeah.
So she comes to me all of a sudden, she's all like, "Hey, I want to start dating other dudes. Like, I don't really think this is where I want this relationship to be." I don't know. I just feel like it came out of nowhere. I don't know. And then, like, last week, I got blamed for doing something I didn't even really do in class. And my favorite teacher is just like, he thinks I did it. And I'm just like, okay, well, life's awesome. It's great. Okay. I don't know. I feel like there's nothing really desirable about being me or just being anything, I don't know, in my situation. I don't know.
Well, how have you been dealing with it so far? Have you been, I mean, I know a breakup can be tough.
Yeah. I don't know. I try to think about it.
And Mr. Rothfuss is so nice. Why?
I don't know. He's I don't know. When he thinks he cheated on a test,
oh,
he tends to not.
Yeah, that's pretty bad.
I don't
well,
know.
Well, look, I'm not super good at this, but when I'm feeling stressed or down, I always go to this verse. It's Isaiah 53:4-5. "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." I want you to have that.
Thanks, man.
And I'll be here for whatever.
Thanks.
You know, they didn't know what need they were looking for in each other's lives. Can anyone guess for the first couple there, the two girls that were talking? One was a single mom, one was her friend. Can anyone guess what that need was? She was feeling overwhelmed. And discouragement was one of the things as well. You know, just all this happening, challenges with a kid at school and other things going on in her life and so, or challenges with behavior at home. I gave these kids verses that had different needs associated with them. Now, I didn't know if they were going to associate that particular need with what the other person was trying to convey and trying to share, but they hit it right on the button. The first one shared the verse for discouragement, and the second one shared the verse for pain and other stuff going on in their lives. I want to walk through, just in the next few minutes, some very... While we do want to be following how the Spirit is moving and leading, some ideas to kind of get some creativity germinated in your mind. Okay, well, what do I do in the moment? Well, there are some things to consider as we think about witnessing. Review and Herald, I want to share this with you just as we get ready to look at this next part here. Go to your neighbors one by one and come close to them till their hearts are warmed by your unselfish interest and love. Sympathize with them. Pray with them. Watch for opportunities to do them good as you can. Gather a few together and open the Word of God to their darkened minds. Keep watching as he who must render an account for the souls of men and make the most of the privileges that God gives you of laboring with him in his moral vineyard. Do not neglect speaking to your neighbors doing them all the kindness in your power that you by all means may save some. We need to seek for the Spirit that constrained the Apostle Paul to go from house to house pleading with tears and teaching repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. So, kind of breaking some of that down, what are some things that we can practically keep in mind as we are talking with, witnessing to, engaging with other people, whatever background they may be from? First of all, listen for hints of discouragement, pain, maybe joy. Maybe there's something you can share with somebody relating to joy. And maybe they're sharing with you something relating to joy. And instead of a verse of encouragement, maybe it's a verse like Psalm 71, 23, and 24. My lips will shout for joy when I sing praises to you, and my soul, which you have redeemed, my tongue also will utter your righteousness all day long. Maybe it's a verse that you have committed to memory that you could share with somebody. But listen for those needs that people have for discouragement, pain, joy as you talk with them. Maintain a prayerful spirit for discernment and the right words. These are things we want to pray for ahead of time. And in the moment, we want to just have this prayerful awareness. Right? How is the Spirit leading me in this moment? Should I walk down this path or not? Sometimes it's easy for human thoughts and feelings to get in the way. And sometimes you might be prompted to say something that you think, I would never say that. That's not me. More than likely, that's the Holy Spirit urging you to say something you may not quite feel comfortable saying, okay? Other times, we're not quite sure, okay, but just a continual sensitivity to the Holy Spirit and how he's leading. Maybe just kind of a check for, am I hearing things the right way? Is this really what I'm hearing? Maybe as you're talking with somebody, says, you know, you ask someone, how are you doing? And they say, well, I'm glad this week's almost over. What does that say? You may say something like, you know, John, you just mentioned you'll be glad when this week's over. Sounds to me like you've had a tough week. Is that right? Am I on the right track, you know? Maybe three different parts here. Identifying what you sense might be a problem. Sharing what you sense may be a problem. And then third, checking it with a question, right? So I heard you say you had a tough week. You're sensing this might be a problem. I heard you say you're glad this week's almost over. What you sense may be a problem. The second thing here, does that mean you've had a tough week? Is that what you're telling me? It doesn't have to be that formal, but you may even just say, it sounds like you've had a tough week, you know. Tell me about it. and then they could correct you if that's wrong. In other words, you're opening up that door of opportunity for them to share. And then as they share, this is what we don't do very often. Listen. Listen before responding. Hey, as they begin to talk and share, and you may ask more questions to, you noticed Henry, well, how did that make you feel? You know, I loved what our young people did this morning, kind of asking some, and I didn't share any of this with them beforehand, okay? These are things that that they did kind of instinctively in the moment. But listen before responding. Ask questions. And then maybe following the leading of the Holy Spirit, there may be a point where you might share a testimony, a short testimony, or you might share a Bible verse. You might offer up a short prayer of encouragement. You might tell them you're going to be praying for them. It may differ from person to person and situation to situation, but following the leading of the Holy Spirit. Here's the good thing. Even if we are not wholly tuned in and we miss a step or we miss something here and there, who's the Lord of the harvest? He's the Lord of the harvest, which means he's working on their hearts with the Holy Spirit at the very moment that you're trying to listen to the Holy Spirit. And he's the one that even if you say the wrong thing, I have had people come up to me after sermons before and say, Pastor Ryan, thank you so much for saying this to me today. It encouraged me so much. And I thought, I didn't say that. That wasn't in my sermon. But guess who brought the message home to their hearts the way they needed to hear it? The Holy Spirit, right? We are oftentimes so afraid when really it's him who's the Lord of the harvest. It's the Holy Spirit who's working through us. It's his words that we're trusting him to put in our mouths. And we are simply saying, use me. It's scary. It's exciting. But I'm going to make room in my life for you to use me. Please, use me. Your Connect card today has a couple of things on the back of it, and I want to encourage you just to pull it out for a second. Whether you use it to respond to the message today or not, I want you to consider it for just a moment. The first box says, under my next step today is, it says, I commit to praying daily that God will help me to recognize opportunities for witnessing. Give me discernment. I need discernment. And secondly here, I want to pray for boldness and the right words to be able to witness to others when God opens the door. And then we're just following where he leads, aren't we? But I want to pray for boldness and the right words to go where he leads. We're going to have a special music here in just a moment. I'm going to finish off a story for you as she's getting up here and getting set. As she plays, the deacons will come around and you'll have an opportunity to drop a card that you're looking at here and in the baskets as they come around. Back to the story at the beginning. In church, getting ready to preach the last sermon in a series of meetings. Got a sermon with a call for baptism in front of me. Where do I go from here, Lord? Not a single visitor from our meetings showed up that day. And I just felt this strong compulsion to preach the sermon anyway and have the call anyway. I thought, I don't know why, but I guess I'm going to do it. So kind of fighting back the desire to change something or to leave something out, I move forward, and at the end of the sermon, there were some people that came to church every week that weren't members. A father, and he had a son, daughter, and he was a single dad. Anyway, long story short, as soon as I began the call, she comes bolting forward to the front. Not running, but I mean no hesitation. Just walking straight forward to the front. She hadn't been to a single meeting. A regular visitor at church, but she hadn't been to a single meeting. And I'm thinking, hey, Lord, what are you doing here? And another lady was her first day there, hadn't been to a single meeting. She stands up and coming to the front. 77-year-old lady, Shirley Pendleton. And so two ladies, and actually Shirley's friend came with her as well. And so So end of the service, and I'm just kind of blown away and thinking, okay, let's have prayer together. We had prayer, set up some studies with both ladies, and went to Amanda's house. And Amanda wanted to study, and her brother and dad were there too, so they just sat at the table, and we all studied together. Grandma and Grandpa were in the next room. They were from a Seventh-day Pentecostal background. Did anyone know there's a Seventh-day Pentecostal church? I didn't either, all right? From a Seventh-day Pentecostal background, and so they believed in the Sabbath, but a lot of other things were not quite the same. And so we studied. Sabbath was the easy one. They were attending church there because there was no Seventh-day Pentecostal church in the area. And so we studied and studied and studied, and Amanda kept her commitment and her devotion there and came through for baptism. And I continued to study with the family after that because I was really hoping that Dad and brother, Mark and Billy, would make a decision for baptism too. And ended up going off to seminary, and they didn't. And I was really disappointed in that. But I was happy and praising God for Amanda. Shirley went and studied with her, and just her and I one-on-one, and what a blessing. This lady was just full of God's Spirit and just was surrendered to Him. She said, you know, a year ago, 9/11 was a year before that. She said, a year ago, September 11, 2001, I was in an airport when all of the stuff happened. She said, we were stuck in that airport for 3 days before we were finally able to come home. Probably hotel, but you get the idea. They were stuck in that city for 3 days. She said, in that moment, the Lord spoke to me and said, it's time to surrender your life to me. She said, it's been a year, and this was my first time in church, and you gave a call for baptism that day. And I just had to respond. I said, Lord, I've waited too long. And so she walked forward and came forward for baptism. Well, she, as we were studying, we talked about spiritual gifts. She had an incredible gift of hospitality, and she became aware of, hey, this is a gift I can use for the Lord. So she called on one of the elders and said, you can teach. I can provide a home. Let's start a small group. And so they did. And she provided a meal every single week, and people would just chip in $3, $4, whatever they could for the meal. They'd come and study the Word of God together. Her daughter was one of those. And she also was ministering to her grandson. What a minister she was. And her friend who helped bring her into the church, she was able to help encourage that same friend when she kind of got disillusioned by some folks who were not being so nice to her and helped bring her back around later. And her friend was rebaptized eventually. Back to Amanda's story. We finished seminary, come back, and I hear the rest of the story. The pastor who came after us was one of our good friends, and he continued studies with Dad and brother, Mark and Billy, and they were baptized. And Grandma and Grandpa, who had been sitting in the other room that whole time, listening to studies, the Lord worked through just some real challenging circumstances in Grandma's life. She got cancer, and they just came to a point of full and complete surrender. They wanted studies too, and they wanted to get the full picture, so they did studies, and they were baptized. And today, Amanda, we got a Facebook message from her a couple years ago. She's living in Missouri. She's married, and she's got a couple of kids, and they're faithfully attending the Seventh-day Adventist Church there, and she just wanted me to know that. And that day, I was thinking about not having a call for baptism. Where do we go from here? What do I do, Lord? God may be laying something heavily on your heart today. And I'm not saying those people wouldn't have had other opportunities, or God may not have called them in other ways. But what if I had not followed the prompting of God's Spirit, even in my discouragement and this idea that this has been a complete failure? And I said, no, I'm not doing it. This is embarrassing. You know, whatever the case may be. What if I hadn't done that day? So two things today. The Lord is also just now moving for me to say, I want to open up a call for baptism as we hear some music on the harp. And thank you for providing some music for us. Lainey's going to play the song Abide with Me as we close, and the deacons will come around, and I'm not going to be embarrassed if nobody comes forward, but if the Lord's speaking to your heart today and saying it's time, no reason to be embarrassed, no need to be ashamed, it's just you and me right now, I invite you to come forward as Lainey plays. Thank you for that. If it is your desire today for God to take you and to throw you out into his harvest field, would you stand with me today as we close in prayer? All right. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your love for us, for your goodness to us, for your compassion, for your grace in looking at us and saying, I know it's been too long, but that's okay. I'll take you now. You can work for me from now until I come again, and I'm happy to have you. Father, help us to have a perspective change, that these people that you have us in their lives, that we may be that person that can reach them for you. And maybe there's nobody else in their lives right now. Father, we don't know how long anybody has, but Father, we pray that you'd give us insight, discernment, wisdom, complete dependence upon you, that you would lead us and show us where you're at work and give us the words to say, Father. We want to depend completely upon you. So, Father, cast us out. Throw us out into your harvest field. You are the Lord of the harvest. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we close, our altar team will be over here on the side. If you need a little bit of extra encouragement today or some prayer, they'll be here to minister to you. May the Lord bless you.